And everybody said another amen. Father, we do thank you for the Bible study tonight here. Thank you for our members, our workers, our leaders, and the invitees who are here tonight. We're asking, Lord, that we reach every life with your word in Jesus' name. Open the pages of the scriptures to everyone. That, Lord, will come alive in your word in Jesus' name. And the grace to be obedient, the strength to follow through, and the power to do your word as you're teaching us. You grant to every one of us in Jesus' name. We'll be increasing in knowledge and increasing in the result of hearing the word of God. Use your people, Lord, as we prepare them for greater harvest in the kingdom in Jesus' name. Thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. I welcome everyone to the Bible study tonight. Tonight we're looking at John chapter 7. I will be studying from verses 1 through to 13. John chapter 7. And we're reading from verse 1. John chapter 7 verse 1. After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee. For he would not walk in Jewry, because the Jews sought to kill him. Now the Jews' feast of tabernacles was at hand. His brethren therefore told, as said unto him, Depart hence, and go into Judea, that thy disciples also may see the works that thou doest. For there is no man that doeth anything in secret, and he himself seeketh to be known openly. If thou do this thing, show thyself to the world. For neither did his brethren believe in him. Then Jesus said unto them, My time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. The world cannot hate you, but me it hated, because I testify of it, that the works thereof are evil. Go ye up unto the feast. I go not up yet unto this feast, for my time is not yet full come. When he had said these words unto them, he abode still in Galilee. Verse 10. But when his brethren were gone, then went he also up unto the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. Then the Jews sought him at the feast, and said, Where is he? And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him. For some said, He's a good man. Others said, Nay, but he deceiveth the people. How be it? No man spake openly of him for fear of the Jews. Those are the verses we're looking at tonight. And you'll see that Jesus Christ remained in the perfect will of God, living for God, laboring for God, loving the people because of the love of God, in spite of the faithlessness, and in spite of the feebleness, and in spite of the unfaithfulness of the people around him. That's why tonight the title of our study is Living for God Despite the World's Faithlessness. Living for God Despite the World's Faithlessness. You will live for God. Whatever your environment, whatever the situation, and whatever the challenges around you, the grace of God will get into your life, and you will live for God in those various circumstances in Jesus' name. I need to point something to your attention before we go on. If you look at verse 2, it talks about now the Jews' feast of tabernacles was at hand. The Jews' feast of tabernacles was very near. And all the Jewish people, the gathering, will be going to Jerusalem. And the whole chapter we're looking at actually centers around and revolves around this feast of the Jews. Look at verse 8. Go up to this feast. I go not up yet to this feast, for my time is not yet full. Talking about the feast. Look at verse 10. In verse 10 it says, but when his brethren were gone up, then went he also up unto the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. The whole chapter is talking about the feast. Look at verse 11. Then the Jews sought him at the feast and said, where is he? And then you come to verse 14. In verse 14 it says, now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. Come to verse 37. In verse 37, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. I read all those verses to you for you to understand that all the verses we're reading and all the verses we're still going to study at another time, they center around and they revolve around the feast of the Jews. And so, it's very important for us, for you and for me to understand the feast which was commanded by God, the feast which was demanded by God, the feast which was required by God, our Heavenly Father. Because if we don't understand what the feast is all about, we will not understand all the things we're reading surrounding that feast. That's why we're looking at the Old Testament now, for us to understand what feast it was, and what was the purpose, and what they were to do as they went to the feast. We're looking at Leviticus chapter 23. Leviticus chapter 23. And we're reading from verse 34, Leviticus chapter 23. We're reading from verse 34. It says in verse 34, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of the seventh month shall be the feast of tabernacles for 7 days unto the Lord. They were to hold the feast, number one, unto the Lord, not unto themselves. Not only that, they were to be there for 7 days. And it is referred to as the feast of tabernacles. Look at verse 35. On the first day shall be an holy convocation. Ye shall do no servile work therein. They were to keep that period as a period of worship, a period of resting, and they will not do any secular work. Look at verse 36. 7 days ye shall offer an offering made by fire unto the Lord. On the 8th day shall be an holy convocation unto you, and ye shall offer an offering by fire unto the Lord. It is a solemn assembly, and ye shall do no servile work therein. We learned something there, that the feast was not for entertainment. It was to be an holy convocation, an holy assembly, a solemn assembly given unto the Lord. It was not to be a carnal celebration. They were not to go there for any fleshly indulgence, and there wasn't any worldly amusement there. It was to glorify God. It was to worship God. It was to remember God. It was to listen to the word of God. It was to learn from the Lord, from the word of God, to reach his word and to teach his word to all the men and all the women and all the strangers and all the children that will be there, to prepare everyone for a greater feast, a heavenly feast, a future feast. And let's come to Deuteronomy chapter 16. Deuteronomy chapter 16, learning about this feast of tabernacles, what the Lord expected of them and what the Lord required of them and what the Lord commanded them. In Deuteronomy chapter 16, we're reading from verse 13. Thou shalt observe the feast of tabernacles 7 days. You see, that is still the same feast, but now they're being given some additional instruction as to what the feast looked like. After that, thou hast gathered in thy corn and thine wine. That was after their harvesting. And after their kind of reaping their field, they will now come to show gratitude unto God. And thou shalt rejoice in thy feast, thou and thy son and thy daughter, and thy manservant and thy maidservant, and the Levite and the stranger, and the fatherless and the widow, and all that are within thy gates. That is, now they were not to exempt anyone. Everyone was to be at that feast, was to be at that meeting, was to be at that gathering. Again, we're reminded in verse 15, 7 days shall thou keep a solemn feast unto the Lord. Remember, underline that, unto the Lord, unto the Lord. When they gathered together, it was to be unto the Lord. It wasn't to be unto themselves for personal gain or personal profit or any kind of fleshly engagement. It was to be unto the Lord thy God in the place which the Lord shall choose, because the Lord thy God shall bless thee in all thine increase and in all the works of thine hand. Therefore shall thou surely rejoice. You will rejoice. Amen. I come into Deuteronomy chapter 31, the Feast of Tabernacles. What was required of them? What was demanded of them? Deuteronomy chapter 31, I'm reading from verse 10. In verse 10 it says, and Moses commanded them, saying, at the end of every 7 years, in the solemnity of the year of release, in the Feast of Tabernacles. So underline that. You know, it's talking about the Feast of Tabernacles. All that we'll be reading now, it gives you the instruction. When you read the New Testament, and the New Testament refers back to the Old Testament, you check up, what's that there for? What were they to do over there? And then it tells us now in verse 11, when all Israel is come to appear before the Lord thy God. All Israel coming to appear. That is, nobody will exempt himself. Nobody will say, I don't think I want to go. I think I'm weak. I think I don't have the strength. I think I'd like to take this time as my time of vacation. I don't want to go with all the other people. Now God commanded it. God demanded it. And God required it. And therefore, when all Israel is come to appear before the Lord thy God, in the place which he shall choose, thou shalt read this law before all Israel in their hearing. You have on the understanding now, when they got there together, they were not just to sit down there. They were not just to maybe be talking and sharing. They were to read the word of God. And they were to read the totality of the word of God without omitting anything. And then it goes on to say in verse 12, gather the people together, men and women and children, men and women and children. You see how important the Feast of Tabernacle was to them, to those children of Israel, all of them together, gathered together. And they were to learn the word of God. And it says, and thy stranger that is within thy gates, that they may hear, you see that, and that they may learn, you see that, and they may fear the Lord your God and observe to do all the words of this law. And so it was very important that they gathered together during that Feast of Tabernacles, and they will hear the word of God. They will learn the word of God. The things they knew before, they'll be reminded. What they didn't know before, they will hear. And then it says in verse 13 that their children, which have not known anything, may hear. That is, we are not to say these are young people, they want to benefit. It says they have not known anything. They will come to that Feast of Tabernacles and they will hear the word of God. And it says, and learn to fear the Lord your God as long as ye live in the land whither ye go over Jordan to possess it. And there's something we should notice about the children of Israel. You see, from the time of Moses, Leviticus, and Deuteronomy, that Feast of the Tabernacles had been given to them. And they continued through the Old Testament. They continued all those thousands of years. Every year, they continued. Until they came to the New Testament that we're looking at today in John chapter 7. And they said, the Feast of the Tabernacles was at hand. Think about that. Doing something for 1,000 years and they continued. And for 2,000 years and they continued. And then until Jesus came and they continued. And you think about your own life. Maybe let's start from our Monday Bible study. There are some people that were attending the Monday Bible study many years ago, maybe about so few years ago. And now you think about them, they're not at the Bible study. Because they think, I've attended for 5 years, for 7 years, for 10 years. We're talking about the people who have attended for thousands of years, and yet they kept on going. I pray God will make you faithful. Amen. Give me a good amen. Other people come to Sunday service, and you know, after coming for some time, if there is rain or if there is you know, whatever little disturbance, they say, I don't think I'll go today. But look at these people, the Feast of Tabernacles, they kept on attending, they got to attending for thousands of years. And you think about our retreats. We have Easter retreat and we have December retreat, and then we have the third weekend, the revival. And there are some people that started, they were excited about those retreats and about the revival sessions many years ago. They will come and come and come, but at this time now they will plan some other things, holiday or vacation or traveling or whatever during the time of the retreat. You see, the Jews, they never did like that. They continued, they were consistent. And praying that as you listen to this today, the grace to be consistent, the Lord will grant unto you. And whatever good thing you have started, you will continue in Jesus' name. Look at Zechariah chapter 14. Zechariah chapter 14, and I'm reading from verse 16. Zechariah chapter 14, we're looking at verse 16. You see, we're getting near now to the end of the Old Testament. And see what the Lord told them at the end of the Old Testament, almost the end. Zechariah chapter 14, verse 16. And it shall come to pass that everyone that is left of all nations which came against Jerusalem shall even go up year to year to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, and shall keep, what will they keep? The Feast of Tabernacles. See how serious God is about this, that he said, not only the children of Israel now, even at the end of time, all those other nations that have been opposed to the children of Israel before, now that they knew that God is a king, is a King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, is a Redeemer, is a Savior, is a Deliverer, you know what he will do? They were expected to also attend this Feast of Tabernacles. Look at verse 17. And it shall be that whoso will not come up of all the families of the earth unto Jerusalem to worship the King, the Lord of hosts, even upon them shall be no rain. There was penalty, there was suspension of blessing, there was withdrawal of blessing if they will not attend the Feast of Tabernacles that the Lord himself had commanded, that he demanded of them. Verse 18, and if the family of Egypt go not up, come not, that have they have, that have no rain, there shall be plague wherewith the Lord will smite the heathen that come not up to keep, tell me, the Feast of Tabernacles. See how important it is. That's the reason why, as we look at this in the New Testament, and the Jewish people said, we're going to Jerusalem and we're going to keep the Feast of Tabernacles, is because the Lord commanded it. Verse 20, in that day shall there be upon the bells of the horses holiness unto the Lord, and the pots in the Lord's house shall be like the bowls before the altar. Yea, every pot in Jerusalem and in Judah shall be holiness unto the Lord of hosts, and all they that sacrifice shall come and take of them and cease therein. And in that day there shall be no more Canaanites in the house of the Lord of hosts. Give me a good amen. Amen. You see, the Jewish people, they were learning that, and they were doing that in preparation for a greater feast that is to come. And we are now in the New Testament. There's something we're looking up to. We're looking up to the time when the Lord himself, when he will come and will take us home, and he'll take us to heaven, and we'll feast with the Lord in Jesus' name. Actually, in the Old Testament, they were looking forward unto that. In Nahum chapter 1, Nahum chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 15. Nahum is near the end of the Old Testament, but before Zechariah. In Nahum chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 15. It says, behold, upon the mountains the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publisheth peace, O Judah, keep thy solemn feast. He's talking about the time of the gospel, when the Lord Jesus will come, a Savior will come, a Redeemer will come, and then we'll have the gospel, the good news, and there'll be those who are publishing the glad tidings and the word of the Lord, the word of salvation. And he says, perform thy vows, for the wicked shall no more pass through thee. He is utterly cut off. We're coming to Revelation, I'm reading from chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19, I pray that you'll be a part of this in Jesus' name. You see the Feast of Tabernacle, that's for the Jews. But now, we're talking about something that will be for those who are giving their lives to the Lord. Revelation chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 6. And I heard as it were the voice of a great multitude, and as the voice of mighty thundering, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. Let us be glad and rejoice, and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. That's going to be a great supper. That's going to be a great feast. That's going to be a great enjoyment up in glory, up in heaven. And I pray you'll be there in Jesus' name. But you know, to be there, you have to be saved. You have to live a righteous life. The grace of God needs to be in your life. You need to turn away from your sin and turn unto the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. And make him the Lord and the Savior of your life. And then he brings his grace to your life as a new life and as eternal life. And now you can say, praise the Lord, I'm washed in the blood of the Lamb. And I'm waiting for that wonderful feast. Look at verse 8. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. That's what it requires. The Lord demands that there be righteousness, there be holiness, there be purity of heart. It says the white linen is the righteousness of the saints. And it says unto me, right, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And it says unto me, these are the true saints of God. Now let's come back to John. As we look at John, we know that although the Feast of Tabernacles was for the children of Israel, for the Jewish people, in our own case, we're waiting for something greater and something superb and something that will be in heaven. And praise God, I'll be there. I said, I'll be there. But you see, the children of Israel, as we have learned, they were still attending this Feast of Tabernacle, but they have forgotten the purpose of those meetings, the reasons for those feasts. And we should not forget the reason why we're coming to the Monday Bible study, the reason why we go to church on Sunday, and the reason why we attend retreats, and the reason why we go to those meetings in our church that the Lord has used over the years to bless us and to revive us and to make us learn what we didn't know before. As I told you tonight, we're looking at living for God despite the world's faithlessness. We're dividing the passage to three parts. Number one, his redemptive courage amidst his foes. That is, we're talking about Christ. His redemptive courage amidst his foes. He obeyed the Lord. He did the will of God, even in the midst of his foes. And then point number two, the real cause of their fury. They were angry at him. They hated him. And they manifested real terrible hatred. What's the real cause for that? What's the root cause for that? You'll see that in the passage as we learn. The real cause, the root cause of their fury. Point number three, the ruinous consequence of their fear. The ruinous consequence of their fear. The fear of the Jews. How regrettable it was. Regrettable consequence of their fear. The ruinous consequence of their fear. Let's come back to number one. Tell me your number one over there. Tell me like you're very sure. His redemptive courage amidst his foes. Let's come back to John chapter 7. In John chapter 7, it tells us after these things, Jesus walked in Galilee. Jesus kept on active in Galilee. Jesus kept on moving in Galilee. Jesus went on from village to village, from town to town, and from one place to the other in Galilee. Why? Why was he doing that? Because those people were receptive. They were receptive to the word of God, and they wanted the word of salvation preached unto them. And because of that, he went everywhere. There were threats and there were challenges, and it appeared that some people were telling him, you know, not everybody likes you. Some people don't like what you're doing, and you don't like this, you don't like that. And look at what he said in Luke chapter 13. Luke chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 31. Luke chapter 13, verse 31. I'm waiting for you. I've opened my Bible. Luke chapter 13, tell me your verse. Verse 31. The same day there came certain of the Pharisees, saying unto him, get thee out and depart, for Herod will kill thee. Herod will kill thee. You know, when you're doing something good, there are people that will come and give you bad news, bad story. They are after you. They're going to catch you. They're going to do this. They're going to do this. They're going to push you up, and they're going to do this terrible thing to you. But Jesus maintained courage. What if Jesus did not have courage? Courage to sacrifice and courage to die for you and to die for me. There'll be no redemption, and there'll be no salvation, and there'll be no deliverance, and there'll be no healing, and then there'll be no heaven for us. That's why we say his courage was redemptive. His courage redeemed us. His courage has restored us. His courage has saved us. Look at what he said in verse 32. He said unto them, go ye and tell that folks, behold, I cast out devils and do cures today and tomorrow, and the third day I shall be perfected. He said, I'm not about to run out of town. I'm not about to stop what I'm doing. I'm not about to kind of go and hide myself somewhere just because Herod is after me. Nevertheless, I must walk today and tomorrow and the following day, for it cannot be that a prophet perish out of Jerusalem. You had courage, you will have courage. Look at John chapter 7. John chapter 7, where the people were wondering, will he come? Will he not come? Will he be there? Will he not be there? John chapter 7, I'm reading from verse 25. It says, then some of them of Jerusalem, then said some of them in Jerusalem, is this not he whom they seek to kill? He came to the feast. You know, his brethren, that is, those who were born by Joseph and Mary, they were saying, will you not go? Come and go now. Go and show yourself to him. He said, no, you go your way. We're not in the same company. We're not in the same group. You go in your own group. I'm going to go when it's time for me. And now he got there. And then they said to one another, is this not he whom they seek to kill? Verse 26, but lo, he speaketh how? Tell me out loud. Tell me the way you will speak. He speaketh boldly, and they say nothing unto him. Do the rulers know indeed that this is the very Christ? Some people recognized him. They said, this is the very Christ, because he didn't allow their threatening to stop him. The threats of the world will not stop you. Verses 30 and 31. Verse 30, then they sought to take him, but no man laid hands on him, because his hour was not yet come. And many of the people believed on him. What if he stayed back? What if he held back? What if he was afraid? What if he was hiding himself somewhere? Because they're looking for you, they'll hurt you, they'll punish you, they put pressure on you, they'll oppose you, they'll criticize you, and they may even kill you. What if because of that you kept somewhere? These people that believed in verse 31 will not believe. You will not hide. You'll not hide your light under a bushel in Jesus' name. Whatever the people of the world are trying to do, their conspiracy or whatever they're going to do against your life, the Lord will protect you. You are the apple of the eye of the Lord, and nothing bad will happen to your life in Jesus' name. And many of the people believed on him and said, when Christ cometh, will he do more miracles than these which this man has done? And so you find that, you know, people in Bible days, they served the Lord. They didn't bother about problems, about challenges, about this and that. Look at Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 6. Luke chapter 1, we're reading from verse 6. And they both were righteous before God, walking in all the commandments of God and ordinances of the Lord, blameless. But look at verse 7. And they had no child, because that Elizabeth was barren, and they both were now well stricken in years. Look at this family. They didn't have any child, but they kept on serving the Lord, and they were righteous and they were holy. You know, some people will say, well, I wanted to serve the Lord, I wanted to be zealous for the Lord, but look at my challenge. We don't have any child, but that child will come. I said the miracle child will come. And eventually, as Zechariah was serving in the temple, an angel came to him. You receive visitation from heaven in Jesus' name. And then eventually John the Baptist came, and John the Baptist was born. A miracle will be born in your home. We're looking at John chapter 7. John chapter 7. I'm reading from verse 2 now. John chapter 7. I'm reading from verse 2. It says, now the feast of the tabernacles was the Jews' feast of tabernacles was at hand. His brethren therefore said unto him, depart hence and go into Judea, that the disciples also may see the works that thou doest. Now these were his brethren, these were his relatives in the physical and the natural. And he said, you go that your disciples will see you. What's the implication of that? We don't believe you, we don't accept you, you are not a savior to us at all, but you have disciples, go to them. And then in verse 4, for there is no man, this is what he said, that doeth anything in secret, and he himself seeketh to be known openly. If thou do these things, show thyself to the world. Why did they say that? Look at verse 5. Verse 5, are you there? Read it out, 1, 2, 3, go. For neither did his brethren believe in him. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ himself has reminded us that they of our household might be the greatest antagonist, the greatest foes. We're looking at Matthew chapter 10, verse 36. Matthew chapter 10. Verse 36. In verse 36, this is what it says, and a man's foes shall be they of his own household. They didn't believe at that time, but thank God later they believed. You see, if you keep on doing what you are doing, saying what you are saying, preaching what you are preaching, living the way you are living, the people who don't believe now, they will believe later. And these brethren of Jesus Christ that didn't believe at that time when he was on earth, later they believed. How do we know they believed? Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1, verse 14. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1, verse 14. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. They came into the kingdom. Your relatives will come into the kingdom. Your husband will get saved. Your wife will get saved. And your relatives who are still saying they are doubting, they don't know whether it's real or not, they'll come in Jesus' name. But the thing is, we must keep on doing what we're doing. We mustn't allow what the people say, how the people act, to hinder us. We should keep on doing what we ought to do. Let's come back to John chapter 7. In John chapter 7, I'm reading here from verse 10. John chapter 7, in verse 10. But when his brethren were gone up, then went he also up unto the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. He knew that the Lord, the Father God in heaven, has commanded that all males and everyone should go to Jerusalem and be at the Feast of Tabernacles. And so even though he wasn't going to go in their group, it's like you want to go somewhere and these people say, we're ready now. You say, no, my time is not yet. You take bus or you take your whatever you want to take and go there. And then after they have gone, your own time has arrived. You're walking to your own time. You're not walking to their timetable. You're not walking to their own stipulation of time. You have your own time, and when you are ready, now you go. That's what happened to him. He went, and when he got there, he looked at the appropriate time, because Jesus Christ, he came to seek and to save that which was lost. And even though they were seeking for him to kill him, he knew that his time was not yet. You cannot die before your time. Whatever the Lord has appointed for you to do on earth, you are going to do before he says, that's enough. You've done everything now. You've finished every work I've given you. Come on home, and you are going to go home victoriously. And it is not Satan that will take you home. It is not persecution that will take you home. It's not all those people that can conspire together that will take you there. When the time comes, the chariot will come from heaven. And the Lord will come from heaven and take you there in Jesus' name. Before that time, nothing can happen to your life. God has a timetable, has a destiny for everyone. And if you're a child of God, praise the Lord. Something good will continue happening to you in Jesus' name. And so, Jesus now got there. When he got there, what did he do? Look at verse 14. Now, in the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple. What did he do? That's his calling. That's his commission. That's his mission. And he went right there and he touched them. He touched the word of God. And he taught convincingly, taught boldly. Look at verse 15. And the Jews marveled, saying, how knowest this man letters having never learned? There will be a testimony about you. And then in verse 16, Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. If any man will do his will, he shall know of the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself. He that speaketh of himself seeketh his own glory. But he that seeketh this glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness in him. And then he stayed there till the very last day of the feast. Look at verse 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried. Let me ask you again, how many days did they stay there for the feast? 7 days. And once he came in like this, he started teaching. First day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day. I thought they wanted to kill him. I thought they wanted to arrest him. I thought they wanted to hurt him. That's what I'm telling you. Nobody will hurt you. It's only your imaginary fear that is keeping you back. Rise up and do what the Lord has called you to do. Your life is secured in Jesus' name. In verse 37, in the last day of the feast, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But they speak him of the Spirit, which they that believe on him shall receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. You see, there are, when we're talking about courage, there are some people that claim to be courageous. But you know, for them, they do things that are risky. They do things that are dangerous. They do things that are destructive. They do things that are damnable. Not Jesus. That's not the courage of Jesus. You see, if you are courageous, you're not going to jump in front of a vehicle and say, I'm courageous. If you're courageous, you're not going to stand on, you know, at the balcony of your house and then jump down and then you kill yourself or say, I'm courageous. That's dangerous. That's deadly. And that's damnable. And that is not of God. But in the case of Jesus, his courage was to give salvation for people. His courage was to preach redemption. His courage was whatever was happening in the midst of the feast, he'll get there and he'll talk about salvation. He'll talk about the power of the Holy Spirit. He'll bring them in so that they can have the blessings of the Lord. That's why we're saying his courage was in obedience to God. It was redemptive. It was restorative. It was responsive to the word of God. The courage to preach, the courage to teach, and the courage to seek and to save the lost, the courage to reveal the truth of redemption and the truth of eternal life. Courageously, he fulfilled his ministry and his mission on earth. Does your courage fulfill your mission, your ministry on earth? Or is it just courage to do some, you know, terrible, terrible things? I pray God will give you wisdom. Amen. Point number two, the real cause of their fury. We're coming to John chapter 7. John chapter 7, and we're reading from verse 6. In John chapter 7, verse 6, Jesus said unto them, my time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. Look up here for a moment. He was talking to people of the same mother, but not the same father. His own father was our heavenly father, God in heaven. You know that Joseph was not his father. Do you know that? Because Mary was a virgin. And then she conceived of the Holy Ghost. But after he was born, then Mary and Joseph had all these others that were referred to as his brethren. And he said, we're different. I am from above. You are from beneath. I am from heaven. You are of this world. I was born of the virgin. You were born by Joseph and Mary. And my destiny is different from yours. That's why I said, my time is not yet, my time is not yet come, but your time is always ready. If you are born again and your people or relatives are not born again, you are not in the same class. I said you are not in the same class. You are not in the same kingdom. You are not in the same group. And so they may do things to say, well, you can do whatever you want to do. I listen to heaven. And because I listen to heaven, I'm going to do what heaven wants me to do. And then it says, the world cannot hate you, but me it hateth, because I testify of it that the works thereof are evil. You see that? That's the real cause why they hated Jesus Christ. And so it said, my time is not yet, but it was wise. It was wise. He now told the people the reason why they actually hated him. You know, there are people that hate the truth. I don't think you are one of those people. I said, I don't think you are one of those people. There are people that hate knowledge. They don't want to have knowledge. They don't want to know about themselves. And it's good to know about yourself. If you're a sinner, then you need to have the knowledge that a sinner is going to hell. But some people don't want to hear that truth. They don't want to hear that knowledge. They don't want to see the light. But I pray that you'll see the light and love the light in Jesus' name. Look at what the word of God is telling us in 1 Kings chapter 22. 1 Kings chapter 22, I'm reading from verse 5. 1 Kings chapter 22, and we're reading from verse 5. It says in verse 5, and Jehoshaphat said unto the king of Israel, inquire, I pray thee, at the word of the Lord today. Jehoshaphat came to Ahab, and Ahab wanted them to go to the battlefield together. Jehoshaphat had made a great mistake. He didn't understand. Ahab and Jehoshaphat were not in the same class, as we have said, because Jehoshaphat was a good king, a righteous king, a person that knew the Lord, but Ahab did not know the Lord. But Jehoshaphat said, king of Israel, why don't you let's hear from the word of God? Then, verse 6, the king of Israel gathered the prophets together, about how many of them? 400 men, and said unto them, shall I go against Ramoth Gilead to battle, or shall I forbear? And they said, what did they say? 400 of them. Sometimes people say majority carries the vote. 400 prophets are prophesying, but they were false prophets. I pray false prophets will not deceive you. For the Lord shall deliver each into the hand of the king. And Jehoshaphat said, Is there not here a prophet of the Lord besides all these? These ones, they seem to just chorus the same thing together, and these ones don't appear to have conviction, and these people are not telling you the truth. Is there not a prophet that we might inquire of him? Look at verse 8. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, there is yet one man, Micaiah the son of Imlah, by whom we may inquire of the Lord, but tell me out loud, I hate him. Why? For he does not prophesy good concerning me, but evil. He tells me the truth, and the truth is bitter. He tells me the truth, and I don't like that truth. He tells me the truth, and the truth is not what I want to hear. Because of that, I hate him. That's why they hated Jesus. And there are many people like that today who hate those who tell the truth. Amos chapter 5. Amos chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 10. They hate knowledge, they hate the truth. They don't want to hear the truth of the word of God, the truth of repentance. No, they don't want to hear that. And the truth of seeking the Lord for salvation so that they will escape hell and get to heaven. That's not what they want to hear. They hate the truth. All they're looking for is entertainment. I pray you'll not be like that. Amos chapter 5, verse 10. They hate him that rebuketh in the gate, and they abhor him that speaketh uprightly. A preacher who speaks forthrightly, a preacher who reads the word of God, a preacher who describes the way of the sinner and the perdition coming on the sinner. It says, they hate him, they hate such a person. Look at Proverbs chapter 1. Proverbs chapter 1. We're reading all this so that when you hear the truth, you will love the truth. You'll accept the truth. You'll believe the truth. And you will appreciate the person telling you the truth so that you can be saved. It tells us in Proverbs chapter 1 verse 22, how long, ye simple ones, will ye love simplicity, and ye scorners delight in scorning, and fools, what do? Hate knowledge. Fools hate knowledge. They reject knowledge. They reject the word of God. Look at Proverbs chapter 8, verse 36. Proverbs chapter 8, verse 36. He that sinneth against me wrongeth his own soul. All they that hate me, what do they love? They love death. If you hate the preacher of salvation, you love death. You hate the preacher of righteousness, you love death. You hate the preacher of holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. That's the only ticket that takes you to heaven. You say, no, I don't want it. Just talk to me about other things. I don't want holiness. I don't want repentance. I don't want restitution. I don't want to know the way to heaven. If you hate those who teach you the word of God, the word of truth, and the word that takes us to heaven, then it means you love death. We're coming to Mark chapter 6. Mark chapter 6, and we're reading from verse 18. Mark chapter 6, verse 18. Let me first of all read verse 20 to you. Mark chapter 6, verse 20. Are you there? For Herod feared John, knowing that he was a just man and an holy man, and observed him. And when he heard him, he did many things, and heard him how? Gladly. That's Herod. John spoke about many, many things, and he spoke about this, Herod said, that's good. And spoke about this, that's good. And then he put good construction on what he said. Herod said, that's good. But one day came. That day, Herod took his brother's wife. And you know John will always tell the truth. If the truth is sweet, he'll tell you. If the truth is bitter, he'll tell you. Come to verse 18 now. For John had said unto Herod, it is not lawful for thee to have thy brother's wife. That's the message. Did Herod take that kindly? Did others take that kindly? Look at verse 19. Therefore, Herodias had a quarrel against him, and he would have killed him, but she could not. And so you find there are people that hate the truth. They hate the word of God. And they say, I don't want that. I don't love that. And it's because they're not willing to repent. Those who are willing to repent, they say, thank you very much for telling me. And thank you so much for revealing the truth to me. I would have perished. I would have gone to hell. But because you told me, I'm going to repent and I will get to heaven. Those are the people we have here tonight. I said, those are the people we have here tonight. You repent and then you turn to the Lord. You will love the truth in Jesus' name. John chapter 15. In John chapter 15, I'm reading from verse 18. John 15, verse 18. If the world hates you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. And so you will not be surprised if you are telling the truth, and then the worldly people, those who don't love the truth, if they hate you, it's not because of anything wrong with you. It's because of the truth they don't want to accept. You see, those Jews, they were so committed to their sin. When Christ came to save and to set them free from their sin, they resisted him with bitter hatred. They held on to religion, religion that could not save. They held on to tradition, tradition that could not save them from their sin. Tradition that could not give them victory over their habitual sinful character. When Jesus showed them the emptiness of their vain worship, and the powerlessness of their vain worship, instead of turning away from the vain worship and abandoning the vain worship, they hated him and rejected him. You know what? They hated the truth. I will not hate the truth. They hated the light. I will not hate the light. Have you got the experience? Look up here for a moment. You know, somewhere is dark. And because it's dark, there's somebody that is trying to do something bad, something evil. And while doing that evil, knowing that he's in darkness and nobody is seeing him, all of a sudden you come in and switch on the light and you're surprised. And because you have exposed him, he's angry with you. Not because you are a bad person, not because light is bad, but because he's doing something evil. And the light you turned on exposed him. That's why they hate the light. They hate knowledge. They hate the word of God. They hate the call to repentance. And they hate the narrow way that leads to life eternal. They hate the revelation of Christ as the only Savior. And they hate conviction that leads to true conversion. Conviction that leads to true conversion. Look at John chapter 8. John chapter 8. These religious people, see them now. John chapter 8. I'm reading from verse 9. John chapter 8, verse 9. And they which heard it were convicted by their own conscience. And they went one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. What happened here is that these religious people, they were not sincere people. They were not righteous people themselves. They had not repented. They themselves were living in sin. And then they caught a woman. And he brought the woman to Jesus and said, you know, this religion, they were happy. Once they're doing religious duty, they are happy. Once they are just religious and traditional, they are happy. We caught this woman in the very act of adultery. Now Moses said, we should stone her. What do you say? And Jesus knew that they themselves were sinners, not willing to repent. They were condemning somebody who was willing to repent. And Jesus said, he that has no sin among you, let him throw the first stone. And then he was writing something on the ground. And when they saw what he was writing and what he had said, they became guilty. And instead of saying, Lord, we're guilty, forgive us. We're guilty, cleanse us. We're guilty, change us. We want to repent, want to have salvation too. No, what did they do? They went away one by one. They went away in their guilt. They went away in darkness. They went away with their condemnation. They closed their eyes to the truth of the salvation of the Lord. You will not be like that. Matthew chapter 13, verse 15. Matthew chapter 13, verse 15. For these people's heart is wax gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes they have closed. You see that? The light was turned on, they closed their eyes. I don't want to say the light. The truth of salvation was revealed, they closed their ears. I don't want to hear that. The way to heaven was revealed, and they just closed their eyes, lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their heart and should be converted, and I should heal them. They didn't want conversion. I pray you'll not be like that. Love the truth. Hate your sin and get saved. The truth is coming. Love that. Knowledge is coming. Love knowledge. Hate ignorance. And the word of God that comes to you to show the way of life eternal. Love the truth. And then hate your sin. And then say, Lord, I'm going to give myself completely unto you. And I will not remain in darkness. I'm looking at John chapter 3. John chapter 3. We're reading from verses 19 and 20. John chapter 3, verses 19 and 20. It says this, and this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light, because, tell me, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that doeth evil hateth the light. Everyone that doeth evil hateth the light, lest his deeds should be reproved. We're coming back to John chapter 7. And now we're coming to point number 3, the ruinous consequence of their fear. The ruinous consequence of their fear. John chapter 7. I'm reading from verse 10. John chapter 7. We're reading here from verse 10. But when the brethren, when his brethren were gone up, then went he also up unto the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. You see something there? Jesus went without noise. He went without sending an herald and saying, I am coming. I'm coming through this road. Anybody wants to meet me? Anybody wants to see me? I'm coming through this corner. No, he didn't do that. Why? Because those people were looking for him. And he didn't want to put, petrol and fire together. He didn't want them to become guilty of murder. Because of that, he went, and he went quietly. And we need to do that sometimes today, that you just mind your business and go where you want to go without too much noise and without saying, whatever people will do, I hear that you people, they are waiting for me at that corner, at that bus stop, in that train station. Okay, I'm coming there right now. I will arrive there at this particular time. And those people are wicked people. And those people are not converted. And those people don't care. They don't even understand the judgment of God. That's why you don't publicize like that. Look at Proverbs chapter 22. Proverbs chapter 22. Very quickly. Proverbs chapter 22, verse 3. A prudent man foreseeth evil and hideth himself. A prudent man, a wise man, a reasonable man, an intelligent man, a man that has foresight, he foreseeth evil and hideth himself, but the simple pass on, the foolish pass on, the ignorant pass on, the unwise pass on, and they are punished. That verse is so important, and because of its importance, that's why it's repeated in Proverbs chapter 27. Proverbs chapter 27. Verse 12, you are going to read this one. Proverbs 27, verse 12, are you there? 1, 2, 3, go. The same verse that we read in chapter 22, repeated word for word. It says, a prudent man, a wise man, an intelligent man, a person that knows how to protect himself, he foreseeth the evil, and he hideth himself from that evil, but the simple person, and they are punished. That's why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 10, verse 16, Matthew chapter 10 verse 16 is saying, you should not deliberately, intentionally put yourself in the jaws of danger and in the jaws of the people that want to destroy your life. You'll avoid evil as much as you can. We're looking at Matthew chapter 10 verse 16. Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be ye therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves. But we need to understand something here. Our Lord Jesus Christ was wise and prudent, yet his wisdom did not hinder him from finishing and fulfilling the whole will of God for his life. You see, there are some people, I'm careful, I'm careful, I'm careful. I will say, why are you not evangelizing? I'm careful. Why are you not talking to people? I'm careful. Why are you hiding yourself inside your house every time? I'm careful. Because the world is dangerous. I don't want to get myself into trouble. And because Jesus Christ also hid himself. You're making a mistake. Jesus used wisdom, and his wisdom did not hinder him from finishing the work that God had given him to do. If your own wisdom is stopping you from finishing the work the Lord has given you, you're not like Jesus. Look at John chapter 4. John chapter 4, and I'm reading here from verse 34. John chapter 4. Verse 34, look at this. Jesus says unto them, my meat is to do the will of him that sent me, and to do what? Finish his work. I want to finish. He continued. He did it every time. He was wise, but that did not stop him. Look at chapter 5, verse 36. Chapter 5, verse 36. It tells us, but I have greater witness than that of John. For the works which the Father has given me to finish, the same works that I do, bear witness of me that the Father has sent me. The Father has given me the work to finish. And he did all the details. And so you'll not say, well, I'm being careful, I'm being careful. Therefore, you're not serving God. I'm being careful, you're not going to church. I'm being careful, you're not coming to Bible study. I'm being careful, I cannot go out. It's dangerous there, it's dangerous there. They say that's happening there. And I have to be very careful. A prudent man foreseeth evil and hideth himself. You're misapplying the word of God. In the case of Jesus Christ, he was careful, he was wise, but he finished his work. You all finish? Yeah. Are you here, my people? Yeah. You finish in Jesus' name. John chapter 17, verse 4. John chapter 17, verse 4. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou givest me to do. Careful, yet I finished. Wise, yet I finished. Prudent, yet I finished the work which thou givest me to do. If you are wise like Jesus Christ, you always find a way to do what the Lord wants you to do. If you are to preach, you find a way to preach. To teach, you find a way to teach. To evangelize, you find a way to evangelize. And if you have to touch lives and reach lives, whatever the danger, whatever the difficulty, there's always a way. You'll find the way to do the work the Lord has called you to do. And thank God, you will finish your work. We're looking at John chapter 19. John chapter 19. And I'm reading from verse 30. John chapter 19. We're reading from verse 30. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. Final. It is finished. There wasn't anything to be done that you had not done. At the end of your life, you'll be able to say like Paul the Apostle, I have finished the course. You'll finish in Jesus' name. See, our Lord Jesus Christ then, true wisdom did not hinder him. God's work still must go on. In our lives too, true wisdom does not hinder God's work. Heavenly wisdom will find ways to do God's will. Let's come back to John chapter 7. John chapter 7. We're reading here from verse 11. John chapter 7, verse 11. Then the Jews sought him at the feast and said, "Where is he?" And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him. And some said, "He's a good man. He healed the sick, is a good man. He opened the eyes of the blind, is a good man. He made the deaf to hear, is a good man. He made the dumb to speak, is a good man. Did you hear? He made the lame to walk, is a good man. Did you hear? He forgave that woman that was taken in adultery, is a good man. Did you hear? He fed the thousands of people, is a good man." Other people now said, "Nay, but he deceives the people." Other people said, "Well, they didn't get near him to see his love, to see his mercy, to see his grace, because he's full of grace and mercy. And those who are far away, they were judging him from a far distance. They didn't come near enough." But it says in verse 13, "Howbeit no man spake openly of him." Why? Verse 13, "Howbeit no man spake openly of him." Why? For the fear of the Jews. For fear of the Jews. Fear is dangerous. Fear is deadly. No matter what truth you know, that truth cannot be made practical in your life if you have fear. No matter you know the way of salvation clearly, to repent, to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, if you fear some people, "If I repent, what will they say? What will they do? If I repent, what will happen to me?" That fear will keep you from salvation, will keep you from heaven. If you know you are to do the will of God, then you are in the boss. And you know the word of God, you know the gospel, you know the word of salvation. You are to rise up and speak to the people. Fear will not allow you to talk. You'll be there, you'll be paralyzed, you'll be impotent, you'll be powerless. You will not do anything, because fear will not allow you to do what you ought to do. Proverbs chapter 29. In Proverbs chapter 29, I'm reading from verse 25. Proverbs chapter 29, verse 25. "The fear of man bringeth a snare." The fear of man, what does it bring? Brings a snare, brings a trap, and brings a net to cover you, and puts you in captivity, and puts you in a dungeon. That all the good things you have, you cannot make use of them because of the fear of man. The fear of man bringeth a snare. How do we counteract the fear of man? How do we overcome the fear of man? And how do we crush the fear of man, so the fear of man will not hinder us from being who we ought to be and doing what we ought to do? Look at the second part of that verse 25. "But whoso putteth his trust in the Lord shall be saved." Whoso putteth his trust in the Lord shall be saved. Whenever fear comes to your heart, you say, "No, I put my trust in the Lord. They're coming and they're going to, you know, destroy you. I put my trust in the Lord. That person is going to hurt you. He's planning something, and you see what he's going to bring out of the pocket. It's going to destroy you. I put my trust in the Lord. That person will not allow you to finish the work God has given you to do. I'll finish because I put my trust in the Lord." If you repent, those people, they're going to make you see pepper and fire. "I put my trust in the Lord. The Lord will keep me safe." Say for yourself, "The Lord will keep me safe. The Lord will protect you. If you repent, if you give your life to the Lord, he'll take care of you. But the fear of man did not allow these people. It says the fear of the Jews. Think about that. Fear of the Jews, fear of man. Fear of losing their place in the synagogue. And the synagogue was useless. The synagogue did not give anything to anybody. And the Pharisees and the priests and whatever, they were not giving them money, not giving them anything. They were even hiding the truth of salvation from them. And yet they didn't want to lose a place that was useless. They didn't want to lose their position that was useless. They didn't want to lose their seat in the synagogue. And yet Jesus said that synagogue, that temple has become a den of robbers. It's like a person not wanting to, a house is burning. And Jesus said every stone will be, you know, replaced. Everything is going to crumble and come down. A collapsing house. And the man doesn't want to lose his seat in a collapsing house. And that's why the fear was unreasonable. I pray that you will not have any fear in Jesus' name. The fear of criticism by blind leaders. Jesus said they are blind leaders of the blind. They don't know anything. They don't know salvation. They don't know repentance. They don't know Christ. They don't know heaven. They don't know the future. They don't know anything. And they allow the blind to make them fearful. And the blind that will lead the blind and they fall into the ditch. They allowed that to hinder them. They allowed the fear of being rejected by cast away reprobates. Already they themselves, those priests, they were rejected. They were cast away. And the person that is cast away, imprisoned by the devil, and Jesus said, your father, the devil, they feared people that had nothing to offer them. Fear is unreasonable. You'll not fear. I said you'll not fear. They feared the people that were lost already, and therefore they lost their own souls. They were not washed, they were not cleansed, they were not converted, they were not born again, they were not saved, they were not redeemed, they were not holy, they were not fit for heaven because of the fear of man. I will not fear. Somebody there, I said, I will not fear. You know, if you are going to do something in life, that fear must leave your life. Let me show you one man before we pray. In Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, and I'm reading from verse 27. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 27. Hebrews chapter 11, verse, tell me. Open your Bible, open your Bible. This is very important. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 27. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king. Think about that. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing, tell me, the wrath of the king. You see, the authority was in the hand of Moses. The rod was in the hand of Moses. And Pharaoh and his chariots, they were going to drown in the Red Sea. How is it that a man that God has called, a man that God has commissioned, a man that God has appointed, a man that God has given authority and power, a man that has the final say, whenever he prayed, God answered his prayer. How is it that a man like that will be afraid of Pharaoh? Pharaoh that will perish in the Red Sea. And so the Bible says that man, Moses, had faith, and he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. He endured as seeing him who is invisible. You trust in the Lord, that invisible God will appear to you. Every situation will appear. Every challenge will appear. He'll take care of you. If you're sick, he will heal you. If you're bound, he'll deliver you. If he puts you anywhere, you open the cage, he'll open your prison door. And you will get to the mountaintop in Jesus' name. But how are you going to fear the rat and fear the cockroach and fear the people that have nothing they can do against your life? From tonight, you are free. I say, from tonight, you are free. And then to get saved, you're free to be saved. Get healed, you're free to be healed. And get delivered, you're free to be delivered. And be an evangelist. I see evangelists there. Are there evangelists here today? Soul winners there today. Where are they? You're free to be an evangelist. And you're free to be a preacher. And all the fear is knocked out of your life in Jesus' name. Jesus is by your side. He's living inside your heart. Is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. You are more than a conqueror. What are you? More than a conqueror. What are you there? More than a conqueror. Thank you. Get up and tell the Lord, here am I today. Nothing will intimidate me. Nothing will make me afraid. Nothing will drive me away from the kingdom. Jesus is mine. Salvation is mine. Righteousness is mine. Holiness is mine. Opportunity is mine. I'm going to serve the Lord. I'm going to serve the Lord. The fear of man bringeth a snare, but he that trusts in the Lord shall be saved. Your life is saved from tonight.